I have plenty of old computers, including this Tandy 1000. Down here I have a Apple IIgs and the much unloved Zenith Easy PC. Up there is my Macintosh Classic. I have a Commodore 64, a TRS-80, a couple more Tandys down there. In that bag is that Toshiba Gas Plasma laptop. I even have some old computers that I have not featured in videos yet, such as this NEC PC8001A. So I certainly don't need any more of them, but when I saw this cute little thing at the thrift store, I knew I had to take it home. There was actually two of these there. They looked to be identical. I chose the one with a less yellowed faceplate, although it has this big scratch in the cover. They're both $12.99. It's a NCR of some kind. Has a 1.44 megabyte 3.5-inch floppy drive, which is the only external drive bay in this whole thing. So it's quite a slimline case. Some indicator LEDs for hard drive access and power, and a big orange power button on the front panel. On this side are some cooling vents. On the other side is a case lock, which appears to be locked, so hopefully I can find a key that will fit that. Otherwise, I may have to break into this case. On the back, there's the power supply for voltage selector switch. There's the data plate. NCR Corporation, Dayton, Ohio, made in USA. Model 0110. There's some kind of knockout plug that's unused. A PS2 keyboard port, 9-pin serial port, 25-pin serial port, parallel printer port, and a VGA monitor output. And then up there appears to be two ISA expansion slots. A computer like this was likely used in a business, and it has a sticker on the bottom saying Pull 4D. No idea what that means. It was missing one of the rubber feet. I only have the small size of these stick-on feet. I'll have to get the bigger size, but it's close enough that at least it sits level now. I did power this on at the thrift store. I plugged it into power, and without a monitor or keyboard attached, I turned it on, and after a few seconds I heard it beep, and it tried to access the floppy drive. I did not hear a hard drive spinning, but the store was pretty noisy, so either it does not have a functioning hard drive, or the hard drive in it is quiet enough that I couldn't hear it above the background noise of the store. So I'm going to defy normal convention by turning it on before I take it apart. I have it connected to my monitor, keyboard, and a mouse. So here we go. We get signs of life on the screen. 640K of RAM. Press F1 if hardware setup is desired. Yes, I desire it. It says flex disk. Setup version 3.01. I don't know if this is in ROM or if it's on a hard drive. Looks like I have to change the floppy drive setting because it's clearly not a 5.25-inch. And it said 640K RAM, so I'll need to change that. Still doesn't say much about its specifications, such as what kind of CPU it has. So I entered the time and date and corrected the floppy drive and RAM settings. And this is old enough that it cannot auto-detect a hard drive, so it gives you an option for the parameter table, which as you can see is quite daunting for a novice user to figure out. It looks like you can enter the cylinder's heads and sectors manually, which I have no idea what it might be, so I'll leave that blank for now. I noticed here, press F2 for chipset feature control. CS8221, chipset feature control. Well, I'll leave this at the default settings for now. So to exit, you press End to save the changes and exit. Looks like it does have some extended memory. So it's 1 meg of RAM total. Memory size error. Okay, I'll have to enter that in the setup. So I'll correct that RAM setting. 384K extended memory. ROM BASIC is not supported, which is not surprising because only IBM had ROM BASIC. So I'll put in my PCDOS 2000 boot disk. Uh-oh. Disk error, insert system disk. I just did. Hopefully it didn't ruin my disk. Okay, I put in a different boot disk and this time it worked. I was able to run Norton system information from a DOS utilities disk I have, and it identified it as an NCR 286 running at 12 megahertz from 1989, or at least that's when the BIOS is dated. There's a CPU speed benchmark, obviously a lot slower than a 33 megahertz 386, but a little bit faster than the IBM AT for a 286 running at 8 megahertz. And that's about it. Well, I took a blind guess at what the hard drive might be. I figured it probably either had a 40 megabyte hard drive or a 20 megabyte hard drive, because those were the two most common sizes of hard drives in the 286 era. So first I tried the most common parameters for a 40 megabyte hard drive, and during the power on self-test, it said fixed disk, but then it just sat there doing nothing. So I figured that was the wrong type. So then I set it to the most common parameters for a 20 megabyte hard drive, and it booted up right into DOS from the hard drive. So it has NCR MS-DOS 4.01, and some kind of expanded memory manager, and some kind of OLF, whatever that means, and we're at DOS prompt now. So there's not much on here, just DOS and OLF. Unfortunately, the OLF directory was deleted, so there's nothing in there, so I don't know what it was unless somebody can recognize just by the name OLF what that stands for. And here the hard drive is identified thanks to what IDE, made by Tom Warren in 1994. It's a Connor Peripherals CP3024 20 megabyte hard drive, one of the early IDE AT drives. Here's SysCheck, and it identified the video as being by Western Digital, back in the day when they used to make video chipsets and video cards under their Paradise brand. It says it's a Paradise WD90C00 with probably 256K of video RAM, so it's just standard VGA, no VESA or anything. That 28 millisecond seek time on hard drive is pretty typical for its age, and that transfer rate is actually pretty good for a 286. And according to SpinRite, there are no errors on the hard drive. Luckily that key lock was not locked, so I was able to remove the cover. There you can see that Connor hard drive, floppy drive. And on the power supply, we have a date code of 9008. So it's a 1990 computer. And those are the two 16-bit ISA expansion slots on a riser card. You can see a whole bunch of slots for adding extra main RAM and extra video RAM, but it doesn't have any installed. So it just has the basic 1 megabyte of system RAM and 256K of video RAM. There's that Paradise video chip with its various crystals and its ROM. There's the system ROM, the little piezo beeper. Right there is the CPU. It's an Intel 8286, 12 megahertz, and the socket for the 287 coprocessor. Some DIP switches there. Luckily, inside the cover of the case, it tells you what those DIP switches do, as well as some of the jumpers.
Configured jumpers and DIP switches.
Dad, what's a DIP?
Also, it looks like there is a battery under where the hard drive goes, so I'll need to try to take this out and see what kind of condition that battery is in. Hopefully it's not leaking. I don't think I've ever seen anything like that. It's a lithium battery, but it's on some kind of riser card. First I thought that might just be a plug-in module of some kind, but it appears to be soldered in place. It's an old Toshiba Ultra Lithium 3.6 volt ER4 battery. Thankfully it has not leaked, so I'll need to figure out some way to get that out of there. Looks like the battery should pop out, but I don't know. It may actually be welded onto those tabs. Looks like I may need to desolder it in order to remove it. Well, that's what happened with the battery. You know, I tried to disconnect it. You can see it bubbling away, and it's letting out a pretty pungent chemical smell, so I'm going to get this thing away from me. The closest thing I can compare its smell to is that of electrical contact cleaner like Deoxit or this no-name brand, which, as you can see, is full of all kinds of lovely chemicals. So I'm sure one or more of those is similar to what that lithium battery was letting out. So I think I'll end it there with this little NCR 286 computer. The computer itself is working fine. I'll just need to finish removing that battery once it's done leaking toxic chemicals. It's certainly a lesson in the dangers of lithium batteries. Even ones that are 27 years old and completely dead can still be quite dangerous if you puncture them.
Tonight's show is brought to you by the fine folks at Hamstrung Electronics, introducing their exciting new Hamstrung Galactic 8 cell phone.
Yes, say goodbye to the Hamstrung Galactic 7. Introducing the all-new flight-friendly Galactic 8, now with more features than ever before. Let's start with the improved battery. It's been encased in our patented asbestos bat cave, an enclosure immune to spontaneous combustion. And the battery's easy to remove for warming your lunchtime hot pocket, too. Mm. And if there's ever a battery problem, the Galactic 8 has a proprietary sprinkler system. Just don't carry it in your front pocket.
Oh, no.
Excuse me, sir. Check your pants.
The lightning port doubles as a bottle opener and a hex screwdriver. Tired of the same old music when you're on hold? The Galactic 8 lets you choose your own uplifting sounds.
Just an earbud of music makes the minutes sail right by in the most galactic way.
Yes, you can foil any would-be phone thieves with the Galactic 8's Taser app alarm system. It's all you want in a cell phone, the new Hamstrung Galactic 8. Additional equipment needed to make phone calls.
The Galactic 8 from Hamstrung, we're pulling for you.